Well, Glen Fern translated means Glen of the Elder, which means it's really a valley, so we're surrounded by mountains. So mountains are very important and very, very much part of the heritage of the local community. Yeah, my name is Eamon Brennan. I'm secretary of Glen Fern Gun Club. I'm a long-standing secretary. I've been secretary for, I suppose, about 15 years now. We were conscious for some time that the grouse population on Ballybrack had got quite low, and we were aware that nationally there was a problem with grouse population, and I suppose, you know, we were very conscious of the fact that our kids could literally grow up and never hear a grouse or never see a grouse.
It's a bird that has declined by 70% in the last 40 years, and this has been as a result of a combination of different factors. At the moment, we'd have in excess of 20 gun clubs involved in red grouse conservation projects throughout the country.
At that time, all we could find was three calling males, and that was enough to say, look, you know, there is definitely a need for help here. We were so lucky because everyone we came across done us good, whereas you'll always come across someone that's going to do you a turn or a favour, but they'll want something in reward for that, you know. I suppose, to tell the truth, the likes of Larkin O'Toole there now was just a lifeline.
I'm Larkin O'Toole. I'm working with the Golden Eagle Trust, and we've been supporting the Glen Fern Gun Club here on Ballybrack Mountain for the last 7 years. We're very interested and supportive of what they're doing with this fascinating upland project, and we feel that there's a real need for this type of cooperation between farming communities, local gun clubs, other landowners and other interested parties.
By 2011 it was apparent that we had plateaued in terms of our efforts to increase the grouse numbers on Ballybrack, and I suppose in our discussions at the steering group meeting that became fairly obvious that we were frustrated we couldn't get any further.
We had done as much as we possibly could to keep things going, and the project was getting too big at that stage. We couldn't do it on our own. And I remember being at a meeting in Ballinafad with Eamon, and at the table the two of us said, look, if we can't get help today, that's it, we're finished.
The National Parks and Wildlife Service seemed to recognise that, and they made an unprecedented offer to part fund the appointment of a full-time manager and gamekeeper, and that's when the whole idea of John Kerzick's appointment was born.
Yeah, we were approached about, I think, 8 or 9 years ago by members of the Glen Fern Gun Club who had this kind of notion that they just wanted to do something about grouse populations on Ballybrack. They'd grown up with this bird and they could see that there was, it was under threat, if you like. It wasn't quite as common as it used to be, and they contacted us to see could we help in any way, basically, and that's how it started.
When I first arrived here, I knew that I couldn't be the traditional gamekeeper of Ireland. I had to be more than just a gamekeeper. I had to be a wildlife manager. The outdoor life had always been a passion ever since a young child growing up in County Warwickshire in England. But a passion for grouse, I suppose, started when I spent a lot of time on an estate in the North Highlands of Scotland. And when I asked the head keeper there for a reference, he kindly actually offered me a job. When I moved to Ireland, I noticed that there were going to be big differences between being a gamekeeper over in the UK and coming to the northwest of Ireland. One of the things that struck me most was probably the fact that working in Scotland, I'd been working on private estates. However, in this part of the world, the area of mountain that I'm looking after is actually upland commonage. And so rather than having one laird or boss, I now find myself working in conjunction with many different farmers, all of whom have sheep on the mountain and have a shared interest in the commonage. So that was quite a marked difference. I suppose one of the other big differences was the fact that I had come from an area that was fairly sparsely populated I'd been keepering in up to 18,000 acres and living fairly remotely, whereas now when I moved to Glen Farn in North Leitrim, I was quite surprised to find that I had a pub within 400 metres. I could get to the shop to get my milk, which was only just down the road. And so I found myself very much in a community, and I think that was quite striking.
Do any of you know what a red grouse is? Okay, there's a few of you that do. The red grouse is a little bird. It's about the size of a hen, okay? And it lives up on the mountains, and it's a game bird. And it's called a red grouse because its plumage, which is its feathers, so it's out of the feathers.
We made an application to the National Parks and Wildlife Service for support. And what happened then was very interesting, because both organizations agreed to partly fund the project manager and keeper, John Carslake. And that led to, I suppose, the project accelerating to where it is today.
I suppose one of the crucial elements to our role in this is that we kind of join forces with the NARGC, and we are co-funding the project on a year-by-year basis. And we see that as a really good partnership between ourselves, the NARGC, and of course the Gun Club, and the three groups together, along with other people, is the best way of taking this project forward.
The huge variety of people and organisations that are interested in this project is probably best demonstrated by the steering group, which sits quarterly and has a huge interest in what we do.
Glen Farn Gun Club and the Bolly Brack Red Grouse Conservation Project is probably one of the most advanced projects we have in Ireland.
The site of the Bolly Brack project is Bolly Brack Mountain Special Area of Conservation. It is a designated Natura 2000 site for various things: wet and dry heaths, blanket bog, ditrophic lakes, millennia meadows. And consequently, because of its designation, the work that we carry out up there has to be very much in conjunction with the wishes of the National Parks and Wildlife Service.
The Bolly Brack project is for us the perfect example of multi-stakeholders and multifunctional approach in nature conservation activities. And we are using this project as an example in the biodiversity manifesto in itself, to illustrate one of its chapter that is related to protected areas. And we also use often this project in other presentations or communication activity to demonstrate what is done and conducted by the hunters for nature conservation.
The job in Glen Farn as a gamekeeper and as a wildlife manager is hugely different to that of a traditional highland keeper or grouse keeper in the UK. The work and the skill set, in essence, is very, very similar, but it has to be tailored to an Irish situation. I always joke with people, but I say it quite seriously, that a journey which should take 15 minutes to get from my house to an area of mountain that I'm working initially used to take me an hour and a half. And that was because when I met someone who was dipping some sheep or cutting some rushes, I would stop, introduce myself, get to know them, then get to know me. It's very difficult to describe a typical project manager and gamekeeper's day, due to the fact that it is very dependent on the season and the time of year as to what my priorities will be. One thing that I do find myself doing more and more now is most mornings I'll have to check the emails on the computer, reply to a few that are pending. The winter months could involve many, many late hours lamping due to the fact that the dark hours of the day are there. The summer months, especially during springtime, could involve heavy emphasis on predator and pest control. And come September, when we get some dry weather in this part of the world, the emphasis of my work has to be on habitat management through controlled burning. So in effect, every single day is slightly different. the Department of Agriculture recently had a site visit to the mountain with over 150 planners who wanted to learn about habitat management in the uplands. Organisations such as local gun clubs who have an interest in red grouse will often be in touch asking me to tell them how to set a snare or make a fox mitten. But at the same time, they will say, actually, you know what, if you could come down and see us and have a look at the ground, all of a sudden I find myself spending 2 days in West Cork having a look at a grouse site and then coming back home and writing up a written report as to suggestions of what they might do to increase their grouse population. When a gun club decides that they would like to do something with the red grouse, it's absolutely essential that they look to see if they have a suitable area of heather. Heather provides the red grouse with approximately 90% of their diet. If the area that they're looking at is dominated by other plant species, such as vast areas of melinia, which the red grouse won't be able to feed on, then perhaps they should think again about their project site. Habitat management is absolutely essential for the management of red grouse and also many of the other upland bird species that you find on Ballybrack Mountain. The red grouse is a ground nesting bird. Its diet consists of approximately 90% heather, and so the heather has to be managed in a way that provides a mosaic of different ages. What we're looking at here is a swath of predominantly ling heather. The ling heather that's growing here is 4 years old, and there are also mixtures of other plant species. The other two dominant species of heather are here. We have the bell heather and also the cross-leafed heath. Mixed in with this four-year-old heather, you will see the grasses, and the grasses actually act as a nursery plant for the heather, which is regenerative. What we have here is an area of longer heather, which is absolutely essential for the red grouse. They will use this longer heather for shelter from the elements, and they will also use it for nesting cover. Essentially, the longer heather should be close to areas of short heather so that birds can get into the shorter heather for forage, they can get out there to dry off from the rain, and they can come back into this longer heather if a predator were to be in the area. They can escape from the shorter heather and come and find cover and protection in the longer stuff.
I suppose one of the management tools is project has adopted is controlled burning, which is quite innovative in Ireland. There's not really much of a history of that, especially in recent decades. A controlled burning done in the right way, in the right place, on the right kind of habitat, at the right time of year, so and so on and so forth, is a very useful tool for managing heathland habitats.
We're sitting in an area of longer heather that was burnt, and it was burnt using a cooler fire. The cooler fire leaves these stooks or plant stems, and the heather actually regenerates from these, and the heather regenerates from the side of the plant. One of the things about a cooler fire that you will see is that the other plant species, namely the mosses and the lichens and the bryophytes, aren't damaged, and so these areas of sphagnum moss here weren't actually affected by the fire, because it wasn't so hot that it would go into the peat. That's something that we want to avoid when we're doing these controlled burns. Cooler fire is actually what we were looking for in this particular part of the mountain. And it's essential that when you're using burning as a management tool, that you understand how the fire behaves and whether or not you want to have a cooler fire or a hotter fire. One of the useful things about having a cooler fire in an area like this is that
because there are quite a few sheep in this area, you wouldn't want the sheep to easily gain access to the regenerating heather. And by having this cooler fire which leaves the stooks, the sheep are less likely to graze the heather because they don't like to put their heads in to get their feed. So that is one of the reasons why we had the cooler fire here. One of the reasons why we do this burning is, yes, for the red grouse, but these patched areas that you see throughout the mountain are essential for sheep. The commonage shareholders that have their sheep on this mountain are hugely in favour of this patch burning effect, in so much as it will actually move the sheep around the mountain.
We're standing inside here in a small area that's been burnt in the past under controlled conditions. Some wildlife people in Ireland don't like the idea of controlled burning. They would prefer to see this mountain managed as a wilderness, but I think that overlooks the fact that this is no longer a wilderness. This is almost like a countryside. We're not living in a true wilderness. We could take the decision not to manage this area and let it go to its own devices, but that could entail just leaving stagnant or more dominant vegetation types in control.
Bullybrack Mountain is a special area of conservation, and burning on a special area of conservation needs ministerial consent. Part of the protocol before a match can even be lit is to draw up a burn plan and an accompanying appropriate assessment that is necessary for the actions to take place. Before burning the area, the different plant species that are found within the SAC have to be checked. The peat depth has to be checked, and it has to be made sure that there aren't any protected plants such as mosses, bryophytes or lichens. Before burning commences, 5 phone calls have to be made, and those are made to the local fire chief in Manor Hamilton, to Camp West 999, to the local Gardaí, to Quilcher, and also to the National Parks and Wildlife Service. These phone calls are made before any burning takes place, and they are provided with a GPS reference of the area that is going to be burnt. After the burning has been completed, then those phone calls have to be made again to inform the relevant bodies that the burning has been finished for the day. So once the food source is definitely there, the gun club should take their area and look at it on a map. They should look at the access that they have to that area. Access is absolutely essential because the work needs to be carried out on the ground. Having looked at the access, they should look at whether or not their project site is an island site, whether or not it is abutted by areas of conifer plantation, whether or not it is adjacent to other areas of mountain or bog, which could also hold red grouse populations. Other considerations for a local gun club would include whether or not shooting of red grouse actually takes place on site. When it comes to people shooting the area that aren't necessarily welcome, dare I say poaching the area, then it's essential that the access is very much controlled to the site. When setting up the grouse project from the start, it's absolutely essential to have a baseline population survey done. The gun club might like to consider the possibility of a moratorium on shooting. Certainly on Bullybrack Mountain, we have a 5-year moratorium which follows on from an initial 5-year moratorium. So there will be, in 2 years' time, no shooting on this mountain for 10 years. When looking at the site, the gun club has to understand that they won't be the only people using the site. There's a decided chance that the area that they're looking at might be an area of commonage. And so the gun club has to understand that it has to get to know the other users. The other users in the main might be the farming community. To get them on side would actually be essential for the gun club.
What we don't want to do as a state body is kind of put a fence around it and say, right, this is really important, don't go near it. We have to recognise that people live, work and recreate in these areas, and we can only manage these sites for the benefit of wildlife with the cooperation of the local community. So it's really important that we empower and encourage the local community to take control in terms of the positive conservation management of these sites.
The Waterbury Black Red Grouse project has been very positive from a sheep farmer's point of view. The gamekeeper on the mountain is a huge asset to the farming community and to the project. He's an extra pair of eyes on the mountain, working through his job, and he's up there day and night on unsociable hours, and he's extra security on the mountain. And I actually met Fox on the road this morning at 8 o'clock, coming down the road there, but anyway, that's one for you, John. The predator control has been very beneficial for the farmers. You can see less foxes and better survival rate of lambs at lambing time.
Predator control is essential when it comes to the management of red grouse. The bird is itself a ground nesting bird, and as a result it's highly susceptible to predation, as are many of the other birds that inhabit the Irish uplands. The hen harrier and the golden plover both also nest on the ground. A brood of eggs can easily be wiped out by a grey crow that flies over the mountain. A hen sitting on her eggs is susceptible to predation by a fox, which is working the mountain and covering up to 35 miles a night. Due to the fact that the predators and pests that I control have no native predators, what I am trying to do is achieve a balanced ecosystem whereby the prey species have limited numbers of predators, but they are not removed entirely. And as a result, birds such as the red grouse and the golden plover can thrive. Predator control has to be targeted at particular times of year, namely during the spring months when young birds are hatching on the mountain. It's essential that there isn't a fox working the mountain. Lamping is the use of high-powered lamps to search for foxes. It's an absolutely essential tool to the modern wildlife manager. The North American mink is a species which, by its very name, is non-native to Ireland and as a result has to be controlled. Different methods of control can be used, such as live cage traps, whereby the animal is caught and dispatched humanely. These have to be checked at least every 24 hours. Fen traps, which are situated in a tunnel with a restricted entrance, which will only allow mink to gain access. The two species of corvid that should be controlled are the magpie and the grey crow. There are various different methods for this. They include the use of Larsen traps during the spring months when the birds are particularly territorial. A decoy bird of the same species is placed within the trap, provided with food, water, shelter and a perch. They attract the territorial wild birds and they are subsequently caught. The provision of grit in red grouse management is absolutely essential, due to the fact that the birds have to have it in their diet and that they will travel huge distances to get to it. The grit works in effect like a pestle and mortar. It will sit within the gizzard of the bird and it will help digest the fibrous diet that is the ling heather.
The grit stations on Bowley Brack Mountain are spaced at 300 metre intervals on a grid network. These are all marked with a GPS, and the flag that you see in front of me is just to remind me where I'm actually going to be digging the grit station. It's not necessarily a job for the faint-hearted digging grit stations when you consider that there's probably over 120 dug and there's another 150 to dig.
The grit used on Bowley Brack is quartz grit. Quartz is particularly angular. Its size is approximately 6 mil and down. However, what you will find is that birds will sift through a pile of grit and are particularly choosy about the grit that they use. The two parasites which can have an effect on the red grouse are the strongyle worm and the sheep tick. Prevention of these parasites is absolutely essential in red grouse management, and being aware of how they affect the red grouse is also key. The strongyle worm can affect the red grouse in so much as it will take the condition of the bird down. Things to look out for in a red grouse which has a particularly high worm burden include its flight pattern, in so much as it will fly in a very gliding flight rather than with rapid wing beats, and also the fact that its tail feathers will look particularly like the fingers on your hand rather than fully feathered as you would expect. Borley Brack assesses the population of red grouse twice a year. That is best practice. During the spring, the pairs are counted on the mountain, and this is done using the tape lure methodology, whereby a call of a grouse is played every 250 metres within a transect through a square kilometre. The number of calling males is then recorded per square kilometre. A total of 18 square kilometres are counted on Borley Brack Mountain. By the time the grouse have bred, the brood counts are carried out. By establishing how the pairs from the spring counts have fared, a ratio of old birds to young birds can be recorded. Therefore, if one pair in the spring have six young in the autumn, then the ratio is 3 to 1, young to old. Many species are monitored on the mountain. We carry out, obviously, the grouse counts annually, but we also carry out the population assessment of golden plover on the mountain, and also the hen harrier is surveyed.
The latest National Red Grouse Survey indicates that there are about 1 grouse per kilometre squared. Last year on Borley Brack Mountain, we had up to 12 grouse per kilometre squared. So ecologically, it's doing very well. There are 4 to 6 pairs of breeding golden plover on the mountain, which is very important. They're an Annex 1 species of high conservation concern. And there are 3 probable nesting pairs of hen harrier. So we know that upland birds are doing very well on Borley Brack Mountain.
This project here, community-based as it is, with a variety of stakeholders who all have their own kind of remit or all want to get different things out of the project, is a very, very cost-effective way of achieving nature conservation within SACs, in my opinion. And I think it plays a very important educational role.
The project carries out many different forms of public relations activities. These vary from people coming to visit us to us going to visit people. We have guided walks on the mountain during the Heritage Week. We have open days to the mountain where anybody of any background can come and see what the project is doing. And we will also go to areas. I find myself often visiting the local national school. We go to game fairs, and I will often take my advice to other areas that are interested in grouse and upland management. An essential part of red grouse management is the management of people. Through talking to a younger generation, we find that we are targeting a younger generation who will take forward the baton of what we are doing at present, and hopefully take the skills that they have learnt on the mountain and apply them elsewhere.
Although we have a number of projects throughout the country, we feel that it's really a template to show others exactly how far a local community group can get in terms of achieving goals, building partnerships with very important stakeholders, and putting the project in a position that it's playing a very important role in influencing policy, agricultural policy, wildlife policy.
Borley Brack project has a unique set of ingredients and circumstances and personalities from and within the local community. It's working on every mountain to a degree is fairly unique, but nonetheless there are aspects of this project that could easily be replicated elsewhere in Leitrim, elsewhere in Connacht, elsewhere in Ireland. And I think the lessons learned, and indeed the lessons that have been learned on site here, should be conveyed and passed on to other gun clubs or local communities who may be thinking of starting a similar project in their local area.
When a local farmer comes to you after the first year that you've been in a place and says, John, this is the first year in my whole lifetime of farming that I haven't lost a lamb, you definitely know that there's support for the project.
Okay, we have a good gun club, but we have the best secretary in Ireland as such. Because without the likes of Eamon on board there, you know what I mean? Eamon looked into licenses and different things like that, whereas things like that were untold of, you know, we knew nothing about them, like, but you had to go through these procedures to get your work done, and sure enough, Eamon stuck with it.
Although working on a project like this demands a fair bit of your personal time, the feeling that you're preserving a species for future generations, a species that's close, was very close to extinction, feels phenomenal. You just can't get away from that feeling that you're doing something for the future, for future generations.
Everyone you get on board are good people, which is most important. But to run a project like this, whether you have the likes of John Carter like or not, you have to have a passion for it.
Some people might be curious as to why a gun club would become involved in a project like this. But what's often not remembered is that gun club people and hunting people are wildlife enthusiasts.
So the relationship between shooting and conservation is very interesting, particularly with red grouse. If you look at the situation here in Ireland, considering the fact the bird has declined significantly in recent decades, all of the conservation work taking place for red grouse is being driven by the game hunting community. There are probably in excess of 50 projects nationally, and all of the local clubs involved and the local groups have an interest in red grouse because it is a game bird. And that's the main motivation or incentive that drives conservation.
As a gamekeeper, you have to love what you do. There's no point in doing it if you don't. And I'm very lucky that I do love what I do. I work in a place that I love and I have good people that I work with.
John's an all-rounder, like he's the gamekeeper, but yet he's that watchful eye in the community. You know what I mean? If he's going down past the farmer's field and there's a cow going to calve, he'll say, Jesus, I better ring that man, that cow is going to calve. Or the same thing, sheep, lamb, and anything like that. If John sees it, the farmer knows as soon as he does. Like, you know, so that in itself was a great bonus.
If you have a passion for what you do, and if you have a love for being outside in all weathers, and for being able to communicate that passion, then I think definitely it's an extremely rewarding profession. I think for myself, the most rewarding part of my job here in Ireland, being able to inspire others, being able to create an environment where people can learn from what we're doing here on Bowley Brack, I think is absolutely fantastic. Thank you.
Thank you.